think of semiconductor companies, a few will come to mind. Intel, the lumbering giant, AMD, the perennial underdog, Nvidia and their guerrilla tactics, and TSMC, the arms dealer. At least for us PC enthusiasts, these are the key players that enable many of the more obvious products that we use to game and work. ARM is making a serious push with IP to target both the server market and also the consumer desktop and mobile markets. While these traditional semiconductor companies seem to be able to more or less satisfy the consumer market's demand for processing chips, the growing cloud computing business is far from getting their needs met. So companies like Amazon, Google, Facebook, Tencent, and many others are developing their own microprocessors. It might be strange thinking of Facebook as a semiconductor company, but it makes perfect sense for companies like these to start making their own chips. Not only is it a bad idea to be reliant on Intel and AMD to provide you with the hardware you need, as we saw last year with Intel's failure to keep up with demand, but making your own chips can also satisfy your business's processing needs more directly and efficiently, and therefore in a more cost-effective way. Amazon's vice president Matt Garman said the following in a recent interview: "By designing chips internally, we can do some very specific things that make sure the processor runs very efficiently in our environment, and that leads to lower costs." How much lower? Amazon's AWS customers are saving up to 45% by using Amazon's custom ARM chips instead of Intel or AMD ones. It goes without saying that making microprocessors is not exactly cheap. One way to keep costs down is to use older processors. AMD might be using the latest 7-nanometer process for the Zen 2 core chiplet, but Amazon is perfectly happy making their ARM-based Graviton processors on 16 nanometers. As a side note, originally AMD were the ones working on this custom processor for Amazon. The K12 CPU is going to be a hybrid x86/ARM platform, but AMD failed to meet Amazon's performance requirements, which led to the server giant moving to design the chip in-house instead. Now, if the large cloud businesses are making their own custom microprocessors, then demand for Xeons and EPYCs will likely go down over time. If the server businesses are not buying Xeons and EPYCs, what will happen to inventories? And if making microprocessors in the latest nodes is getting more and more expensive, you'd think that it's very risky to be making expensive general-purpose microprocessors these days. Well, AMD has, as we know, a solution for this: chiplets. They can be used in the consumer market with their upcoming Ryzen 2 processors, but also placed in a system in package with several chiplet pairings to form the EPYC 2 server parts. So even if demand for EPYC 2 chips isn't as high as AMD hopes, AMD can repurpose those same chiplets for consumer parts, and presumably also for the upcoming consoles. This is the great thing about the system-in-package model, and the very cost-effective strategy for AMD, who don't have pockets as deep as their competitors. Necessity is the mother of invention, as they say. But what about Intel? Why aren't they creating a chiplet package like Zen 2? Well, Intel's dominance and deep pockets have allowed them to create many more semi-custom solutions for different markets, and the orders for their Xeons, at least in the short term, show no signs of coming down. It will take some time for hyperscalers like Amazon to implement their own custom solutions in mass, so they will be depending on Intel to continue satisfying their needs, at least in the short term. But Intel too see the writing on the wall, and have been exploring different approaches to chip making, namely 3D stacking. But what's so special about this 3D package? Is 3D stacking better than the 2D model that Zen 2 is using? How will these 3D stacked chips help Intel not only remain relevant, but competitive? Well, let me ask you a question first. If we can't push clock speeds much higher than 5 GHz, and if software developers aren't taking advantage of many core CPUs, what do you think is the next low-hanging fruit to get more performance out of processors? To understand why Intel is betting hard on 3D stacking, we need to look back to the early days of the personal computer. Back in 1983, when Steve Ferber and Sophie Wilson were working on the first ARM processor, they quickly came to a realization about general processor performance. We had formed the firm view that the primary determinant of a computer's performance is the memory bandwidth you can access to the processor. The 16-bit microprocessors of the early 80s couldn't use the memory bandwidth that people put into the machines of the time. People were buying extra memory, putting it into their systems, and the processors couldn't even use it. Acorn's solution at the time was to create a different microarchitecture with a reduced instruction set that could increase memory bandwidth, and the result was the first ARM chip, a processor that was twice as fast as the competing x86 products and 25 times faster than the Acorn chip it was replacing, all because of memory bandwidth. If you remember my video from November of last year titled The 7nm War of 2019, I predicted the Ryzen 3800X will have 64 megabytes of L3 cache, and a few recent leaks of the 12-core parts seem to confirm my predictions. As you probably know, the more cache a processor has, the less often it has to hop to system RAM, and therefore the faster it will be. And remember, just like Steve Ferber said, memory bandwidth is a determinant factor to a processor's performance. Our 2D package, like the one on Zen 2, has a lot of interesting advantages, and we'll look at those in a second, but it also has some limitations. For instance, it's somewhat limited to how much cache it can have, naturally, because of the physical space on the die. Having in-die larger caches would mean larger chiplets, after all. If you look at the current Zen processors, you'll see that cache already takes up a ton of space on the CCX, and for Zen 2, if my predictions from December are correct, AMD are doubling the amount of cache. Larger chiplets would mean lower yields, which would defeat the purpose of chiplets altogether. This is something that AMD will mitigate with Zen 3 when it moves to a 2.5D package, but we'll talk about that one in a future video. But if you can stack things vertically, then memory can be added off die on top of the other components. I believe that this is precisely where Intel expects to have an advantage over AMD in the next couple of years. On Intel's 3D stack chip, as you can see by their Foveris presentation, memory can be placed on top of the other components in the system in package. This can be either RAM or off-die cache memory, or a combination of the two. Massive amounts of DRAM with wider buses and high-speed links would allow for really fast integrated graphics, for instance. In other words, 3D stacking allows Intel to build its own Voltron chip, an APU-like product that would finally overcome one of the great barriers to APU performance, memory bandwidth. And for high-end CPUs, this memory can be instead off-die cache of epic proportions. How large are we talking about? Gigabyte large. That's right, while AMD's flagship 3800X will likely have 64 megabytes of L3 cache, don't be surprised if Intel brute forces their way to the top again with hundreds of megabytes of L3 cache, all the way up to a gigabyte of cache, not in a distant future, but in their 10nm process parts for 2020 and 2021. Looking at the first Foveris product, codenamed Lakefield, which is coming to market in a few months' time, you have the base interposer, which is active. In other words, this works as the I/O controller, similar to AMD's large separate I/O chip in Zen 2. And then on top of that, you have the CPU cores, the graphics processor, and other accelerators. This is actually not the first time that Intel has done such a design. You can look all the way back to the Pentium 2 in the late 90s, where Intel was experimenting with off-die cache. And of course, companies like Xilinx have been doing 2.5D and 3D stacking designs for quite a while now. This Lego-like formula for 3D stacking gives Intel a lot of flexibility, and many different products will emerge from this package design philosophy. There are, of course, downsides to 3D stacking. With Zen 2 in a 2D package, because components are placed at some distance from each other, heat is a lot easier to manage. It's also easier to manufacture with a combination of optics and EUV. 3D stacking, on the other hand, presents massive challenges when it comes to managing heat. Having components on top of each other means that when they are active at the same time, heat spots will be created. Intel seem confident that they will be able to tackle this problem by placing components smartly in a stack, but I suspect that for the first generation of Foveros products, Intel will have to significantly lower clock speeds. These will also be very expensive parts on the level of the 9900K, so the question becomes, with an Intel 3D stack CPU with hundreds of megabytes of cache but at say 3 GHz, be faster than a 3800X with only 64 megabytes of L3 cache but running at 5 GHz? If history is any indication, clock speeds don't mean that much. AMD had a 5 GHz CPU back in 2014, the FX9590, and that couldn't hold a candle to Intel's 4770K, which boosted at 3.9 GHz. Intel was over 1 GHz behind in clock speeds, but was still much faster. So yes, I think it's likely that once Intel brings Foveros to the desktop, it will again be fighting for the performance crown. When will this happen? My guess is the second quarter of 2020, so at best a whole year from now, and just around 8 months after AMD releases the Zen 2 CPUs. This certainly gives some credence to those who think that AMD will be sandbagging some of the Zen 2 products, launching the 12-core 3700X first and only launching the 16-core 3800X later this year in the fourth quarter to take advantage of the fact that Intel will have nothing to compete for so many months. It's possible, but personally, I don't think this makes much sense. AMD currently have only 15% of the desktop market and 12% of the laptop market, so what's there to sandbag? AMD will have at least half a year of performance dominance, so they need to come out with guns blazing and get as many sales as possible in that period. AMD need to use that window of opportunity to flood the market with their products and gain mindshare. Sandbagging is for market leaders, not for the underdog, which AMD still are. Now, going back to the differences between the 2D approach and 3D stacking, economics are of course at the heart of these companies' decisions when it comes to building the next generation of microprocessors. In this 3D stack design, just like with AMD's 2D package, some components will be on the latest process, which for AMD is 10 nanometers, while others will be on 16 nanometers and maybe even on 22 nanometers. This flexibility means that the Foveros design will also eventually make it into server parts, just like the same Zen 2 chiplets can be used in a desktop and in servers. But the difference with Intel is that for servers, they will continue pushing multi-die systems, benefiting from the lower power consumption and packaging flexibility. Intel can make 3D stack Xeons with integrated GPUs and even with FPGAs for clients like Microsoft and their Azure business. So while AMD are demoing single socket solutions with EPYC 2 against Intel's current dual socket solutions to show how much faster they are, I believe that Intel's strategy will be to add even more CPUs to their server boards, at least for some types of applications. The Foveros design certainly makes a good case for this strategy. Yes, AMD's chiplets are a very clever solution to their particular context in the market, but Intel's 3D stacking is a lot more flexible, especially considering they have historically created many semi-custom solutions for many different types of customers. 3D stacking makes perfect sense for Intel's business context across several market segments. So even though 3D stacking has inherent performance advantages with memory bandwidth, while in turn the 2D package has advantages in heat management which allows for higher clocks, it's not so much that one is better than the other at this point in time, it's more the case that AMD and Intel will choose the solution that fits their business strategy more appropriately. But it's undeniable that in the long term, 3D stacking will become the norm, and Intel is getting there first, so AMD's dominance in CPU performance will probably be very short-lived. Now, before you add your comment below the video telling me that I'm an Intel shill, let me just say that I don't care who does 3D stacking or 2D or 2.5D packages, I only care about innovation and my wallet. There's this trend of hating on Intel because of their lack of innovation for so many years, and I understand we all like to support the underdog, but if you want processors to continue to get faster, Intel's approach is what will get us there, because like I showed in my last video, adding more cores like AMD is doing will help with performance gains, but only to a certain extent. To get better CPUs and APUs at lower prices, we need this innovation from Intel. Now, of course, there's nothing stopping AMD from creating 3D stack chips themselves. Mark Papermaster had this to say in a recent interview. For CPUs, we looked at the analysis of a 3D stack versus a planar integration of those chiplets. It's always an individual optimization for the use case, a constant re-evaluation at every generation. This is true, but what Mark Papermaster isn't mentioning is that to move to 3D, you need a lot of money. So AMD's strategy is to make as much money as possible with Zen 2 before Intel can respond, and then themselves move to 3D stacking in the next generation's Ryzen. My guess is that Zen 3 in 2020 will be a 2.5D package with an interposer, and Zen 4 in 2021 will be 3D stacked, just like Intel's Foveros products. We can see some tectonic shifts happening in the semiconductor world that can result in fierce competition in the consumer and server markets between Intel, AMD, and ARM. If you want to know why I'm not including Nvidia here, then check out my video on Jensen Huang to understand why. If Intel's golden egg goose, the server market, is segmenting into custom solutions based on ARM IP, then they will need to refocus back on the consumer market to increase profits and remain competitive. So that's one bonus for us consumers, as competition obviously will lead to lower prices on CPUs and APUs. For those of us enthusiasts with lower budgets, this also means that in the next couple of months, AMD will start slashing prices on their current Zen Plus CPUs and APUs to empty inventory. Starting next month, you will see the 2600 and 2700 parts being discounted, and then the X variants in April will also start coming down. If you're like me and always stay a generation behind, the next 3 months will be a good time to buy computer parts. If, on the other hand, you are looking to build a high-end PC, then wait about 4 months and you'll have the Zen 2 products on the shelves. And like I said, I don't believe that AMD will be sandbagging any of them. So while things seem relatively straightforward for us enthusiasts in terms of buying decisions, if we take a broader look at the market, things are not so simple. We sometimes forget that enthusiasts are a tiny minority of PC users, and even a minority within PC gamers, let alone gamers in general. First of all, the market in general is not necessarily looking for more performance, but rather more availability, lower prices, and lower power consumption. This is especially the case with the cloud sector and in the mobile market. Now, you might have a passing interest in the mobile market, but the server business? That probably doesn't excite you as much. After all, you are probably not buying a $10,000 server for your home anytime soon. But now, more than ever, the server sector is closely tied to how the games industry is progressing, not to mention video streaming and the AI boom that's going on. Even though I'm not usually into battle royale games, I have to say Apex Legends is a really good game. In fact, it's one of the best games to come out in a long while. Maybe you don't agree with that statement, but the vast majority of gamers certainly seems to. At the time of making this video, Apex has been out for just over a couple of weeks and already has over 25 million players. To put that into perspective, one of the most successful games of the last decade, Fortnite, took 41 days to hit 20 million players. And of course, to play either of these games, you need servers, lots of them. And Apex hasn't even launched in China yet. If trends in gaming are any indication, the demand for servers to enable this form of entertainment is only going to grow. Interestingly enough, conversely, the local hardware requirements for most popular games in the world are very modest. Apex, arguably one of the best games to come out in a long while, runs perfectly fine on an APU and is free. The same is true for Fortnite. Going over to Steam, and in the top 10 games, the only one that requires a more powerful gaming system is PlayerUnknown's Battlegrounds. Everything else will run fine on a sub $200 PC. This means that the most popular games are running on commodity hardware locally, but require big expensive servers remotely. The need for high-end hardware is gradually moving to the services part of gaming, rather than to gaming boxes themselves. And if the server market is investing investing so heavily into their own internally developed microprocessors rather than relying on Intel, you can see the implications that this change in the games market could have for both Intel and AMD. If you watch my video on ARM from back in December, you'll know that Apple is also ditching Intel in favor of ARM-based chips. Microsoft is also investing heavily in a version of Windows that runs on ARM-based always-connected devices, meaning these will make use of edge computing to do a lot of the processing rather than needing powerful, expensive hardware on local machines. These shifts happening in the games industry will have massive repercussions in the hardware industry, and this has a bittersweet taste to it for me. As an enthusiast, I've always been excited about the games industry's constant push for more realistic graphics, and it's traditionally been on the PC that we've seen efforts made in this direction. But who's going to be investing millions of dollars into realistic environments and immersive single-player experiences if there's so much money to be made in the live services model like with Apex and Fortnite? After the success of Apex and the relative failure of Battlefield 5, what types of games do you think EA will be investing more resources into? Games with realistic graphics and real-time ray tracing, or simpler-looking games that run on commodity hardware? As a parting footnote, do you think the upper management at these companies are paying attention to all of this? I mean, why would Nvidia release the RTX cards when the market is clearly going in a different direction? If you haven't already, consider subscribing to the channel, as we'll be discussing this and other related topics in the very near future. This video is made possible by my awesome patrons. You can join them for just $1 per month and get exclusive access to the Cortex Discord server. You can now also support the channel by buying a Cortex t-shirt. Check them out below the video. If you can't contribute financially at this time, then please give this video a like and share it on social media, as that really helps. Thanks for watching, and until the next one.